colleagues of MBS. He's now an associate professor in computer science at Arthur's University and has been researching the design of bus and bus environmental environmental. Let's welcome Hanoi.
Corresponding to what I just mentioned, we would like our representation to be permutation invariant. which means that no matter how we represent the nodes, no matter what, in what order would they come, in the matrix order, if we have an adjusted list, it shouldn't matter. Right, so that's a basic, that's a fundamental requirement. For example, look at those examples of networks here. Like I've rotated them a bit from, you know, respect to each other and squeezed them and so on, but actually all of those networks that you see are actually the same. They're just differently presented in the picture. And yeah, so we would like to be able to discover that those are the same no matter how we represent them as a matrix or whatever we do. And secondly, we would like our representation to detect similarity at different scales. So as I mentioned before, if you have graph at a distance, you just know whether an edge did got deleted and, you know, to move from one graph to another. But you have no information about where this edge was, what role it played in the topology of the network. Is it just a minor edge? Is it an edge connecting two components that now became isolated? You know, all those issues are not represented. So let's get an intuition of what we mean by scale adaptivity. So these two networks, I think that we see them, we can observe that they have some similarity in their local structures. Well, they don't have very similar structures globally. You know, they don't look like each other in large scale. But locally, they have something similar to each other. So that is something we would like to represent. For another example, these two networks. I think that if you look at them, you realize there is something similar about them in a global scale. Right, they both have a central hub and some connected, detached, connected neighborhoods around them, and those neighborhoods form cliques. Those cliques may be a different size, but I think we perceive that there is something similar in the structure of these networks. And actually, in this case, they're also similar at a global scale, as well as, in a sense, in local neighborhoods. So that is something we would like to be able to detect. And third, we would like our representation to detect similarity even across networks of different size. For example, look at those two. They're quite different in terms of size, right? So this is small and that's big. Different end, different size. But still, I think that you can perceive that the large one or the red one is like a scaled up version of the other. So if you do a naive comparison based on graph at a distance, or if you just compare the two matrices, you're not really going to see them. So we would like to have a method that realizes that represents the similarity even of this kind of things. So that is a quite hard task we have set for to achieve. And fortunately, there is a way to do that. And that's what I will present to you. So there is a way to achieve permutation invariance, scale adaptivity, and size invariance. And also, we have a method that can scale. So it can be computed quickly, and it can, you know, can facilitate comparisons over large graph collections. So the tool we want to use for this purpose is what we would like to draw some knowledge from spectral graph theory, and will be based on the graph's Laplacian matrix, which allows us to perform this job. And what we create is called the network Laplacian spectral descriptor. Well, before we move on, let's see some background. So we are based on the theory of optimal transport, which provides some foundation for comparing probability, the geometry of probability measures supported on space, and that goes back to the work of Monge from centuries ago and Kantorovich. And we're all quite familiar with the derivation of such work because that's what we use also when we talk about Earth movers distance that we have seen in this workshop earlier. So there is a problem of determining how this probability distribution, can be converted from nu to n. And in the discrete case, this problem can be solved by linear programming. And so in the general case, it leads to what we call the Wasserstein distance, which is a generalization of Earth mover's distance. And furthermore, in a more general case, we are led to the Gromov-Wasserstein distance, which facilitates comparisons among Riemannian manifolds, like between this x and y. So in this case, we may not have direct way to map one item in this manifold to one point in the other, but still there is a way to just map a pair, so to decide which distance among the pair corresponds to what other pair, and find actually the optimal way to make this correspondence. And that has a mathematical expression that looks like this. So the Gromov-Wasserstein distance between two manifolds corresponds to the best way of deciding that the pair of I and I prime in one manifold corresponds to J and J prime in another, so that the distance between those two corresponds to the distance among the other two, and you measure the difference or the norm among those two distances. And you actually find the infimum of all ways you can find that you can make this assignment. Actually, that is not something that we are going to compute. We are just providing this as mathematical background. And now let me give you some other background. So there is the problem of the diffusion of heat in a network or in a graph, actually also in a manifold, but we care about graphs here. But as you see, there will be a correspondence between Riemannian manifolds and graphs. And that goes back to Newton's law of Kolbing, which says how, so our physicist colleagues use that quite often. And interestingly, when you study the heat diffusion in a network, so you assume that every node of the network is a source of heat, and you want to determine how heat spreads from one node to all the others. And you can actually construct a matrix, the heat kernel matrix, that exactly expresses this heat diffusion process. So this diffusion is described by this differential equation where this matrix L appears, and that is actually the Laplacian matrix of the network. The standard definition of this matrix is like this. So this A is the adjacency matrix of the network, of which we heard about earlier, and this D is a diagonal matrix that has the degree of every node at every position. So that's the standard Laplacian matrix that enters this equation according to Newton's law of Kolbing. But actually there is also a normalized form of the Laplacian matrix, which is computed like this, where I is the identity matrix. And actually, for our purposes, we find out that this normalized Laplacian is more appropriate to describe structural properties of the network, because it has, so the eigenvalues of this matrix have several interesting properties. They describe the number of connected components, they describe whether the graph is bipartite, and so on. So we are interested to use this Laplacian. And now, interestingly, this heat diffusion process, so where we can also use the normalized instead of the unnormalized Laplacian for our purposes, has an explicit notion of scale. So you can have this time dimension, which actually is computed thanks to the through the eigencoefficient of the matrix in this form, and eventually you have this expression through the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the matrix. And this t parameter is a time measure, time variable, that expresses how heat is diffused from one node to all others as time goes on. And actually, the heat diffusion process is an interesting expression of the structural properties of the network itself. So that's what we would like to work with. So to make things more concrete, here's an example of the heat kernel matrix, this HD. And that's how much heat has diffused from one node to others at after a very short time after the process starts, so heat is concentrated on the sources. And as time goes on, the diffusion takes this kind of form. And the form that this diffusion takes relates to the structure of the network. So that's something that we would like to use. Now, to bring those two backgrounds together, so I talked to you about the Drohm-Vashon transistors and I talked to you about heat diffusion. Those two are related because you can actually have a spectral definition of the Drohm-Vashon distance. So you define a distance among those heat kernel matrices of two, actually you can do that even for two Riemannian manifolds. So people are using this in shape analysis. So it would be interesting to define the distance among two networks through the distance between the heat kernel matrices that they induce. And so then we would have to compute this where we don't only have the infimum we had before, we also have a supremum across all time scales. Okay, so that sounds very interesting mathematically. But unfortunately, these are not, so all this background is not something we can really compute. So having the tech approach up to now, I'm not suggesting that we implement that. So we have to find a way to turn that, all this background, to something computable and implementable. Fortunately, there has been recent work in the field of computational geometry, so computational harmonic analysis by Facundo Memoli, actually quite a brave work in that area, that shows a lower bound for this spectral Drohm-Vashon distance among Riemannian manifolds. So this distance can be bounded by the supremum of this distance among traces of the heat kernel matrix among all time dimensions, all time scales. And this trace of the heat kernel matrix is something that you can compute easily, relatively easily, as we will see. And so the inspiration is that we can use those traces as expressions of the structure of networks. And we can compare networks in this way. Of course, we're not going to use this lower bound itself because it also has this, it's a continuous bound for a manifold. But we can collect a vector of traces of the heat kernel matrix and just construct such a vector for every network. And then we compare those vectors. So that's what we are going to do. And eventually, yeah, so here is the equation. That's the first equation in this presentation that actually corresponds to something you need to implement to apply our work. So that's what we implement. Actually, we have, okay, we need the eigendecomposition of the normalized Laplacian matrix that gives us these eigenvalues. And we sum them up in this way to compute the heat trace at one time scale. And we do this for several time scales, actually logarithmically distributed across a range. And that's how we obtain a vector. In our experiments, it has 128 dimensions. So we have 128 values of t that gives us heat traces like this one. You do this for every network, and then you can compute distance among networks just as a distance among vectors in a Euclidean space. And so that's not the end of the story, however. So remember those three properties I mentioned at the beginning: permutation invariance, scalar appearance, size invariance. You get permutation invariance because the eigendecomposition gives you that by default. That's a mathematical property. It doesn't matter how you construct your Laplacian matrix, you always get the same eigenvalues. We also get scalar ability also thanks to the eigendecomposition. So those eigenvalues also expect those eigenvalues and the time scale that we're using have the property of expressing properties of the network at different scales. But how do we get size invariance? So I mean that's our contribution to the theory we're inheriting from. You can get, so in our world, we know how to do something to have this size invariant. We normalize. We do normalization. So we propose that we normalize these heat traces by dividing each one of them by the heat trace of the complete or the empty graph of equal size, which is something definable actually. So even an empty graph has a heat trace, the heat trace is actually equal to n, and even a complete graph has a heat trace. And in the case of the complete graph, the normalization is even more interesting because not only we normalize by graph size, but also normalize in a way that makes all heat rays at all scales comparable to each other. And so, yeah, so that's the good news. But still, we need to compute this eigendecomposition. And so we have a proposal for that as well, because that's expensive in itself, it takes cubic time to get all eigenvalues. We have a proposal for that as well. So one way you could go is to compute the Taylor expansion, you just use the first terms of that. So we consider that, but we opted against it because it's even more convenient to just use existing methods that give you the top few and bottom few eigenvalues of the matrix. And you just approximate the rest by assuming they have a linear dependence. And that this assumption actually corresponds to an assumption about the underlying manifold. So in all this story, it is always assumed that a graph is a discretization of an underlying Riemannian manifold. And that's why we use all this theory. I mean, the lower bound, memory's lower bound about manifolds is reasonably applicable to a graph as well, given the fact that the eigenvectors of the normalized Laplacian of a graph, as a point cloud graph becomes more dense, converts to the eigenfunctions of the underlying Riemannian manifold of which the graph is a discretization. So that's the underlying theory. And then so we can compute just these eigenvalues, top and bottom, and work with them. And so now comes the time of test. So that's what we propose. And as you see, we have done many approximations in the process. We start with the spectral chromophage time distance. We see that there is a useful lower bound for that. We don't even compute the lower bound itself. We just assume that we are inspired by the lower bound to construct a vector representation, which consists of heat traces. And then we even approximate these heat trace values by using the approximated eigenvalues. So let's see how good or how well all that works. So here are some results. We generated synthetic graphs either by the Erdős-Rémy random graph generation model or by stochastic block model. Why did we do that? We tried to generate some graphs that have community structure and some that do not. And we train and we want to detect which graph has or does not have such community structure. So here is our work. So that's the version of what I described without normalization, and that's the version normalized by the complete graph. And here we have another variant of the proposal, where instead of the heat kernel, we use the wave kernel. What's the difference? The wave kernel uses the same exponentiation equation, but it has the imaginary I as well on the exponent. So it starts the process of how the wave propagates in a graph. So what we got, and these are some competitor methods, these are previously proposed works on how to represent a graph as a network, which are not based on those mathematical foundations, but just based on it to extract some statistical properties of the graph. So that's the Ikerchev classification, and we try graphs of different sizes. And actually, to test the size invariance, we actually collect graphs of size forming a Poisson distribution around these values. And as you see, we see that so the highlighted methods are the ones that have performed best. So we do quite better than previous works. Notice that we have from the range of 50s, we move up to the 70s and the 72 classification accuracy. Here we have another experiment. Actually, here we move to real data. So these are a collection of data sets that either express social networks, collaboration networks, movie databases, and so on. And we do the following task. We take some of those real graphs, and we make some changes. So we rewire some of the edges while preserving the edge distribution. And we want to see whether we are able to detect which graph is real and which one has been rewired by this technique. And again, we do that by, notice that we answer these questions by nearest neighbor classification. So we just left data some data, and we try to find the level of an unrelated vector by assigning the level of its nearest neighbor. So there is not even machine learning going on for training the classifier. We have actually tried that as well. And the improvement that we got was so small that we considered this pure, just this nearest neighbor classification more interesting. As you see again, we perform quite well. So we do better than all previous works. And we see that sometimes the heat kernel-based method goes well, sometimes the wave-based one. And here's another work where we have to, so those real data sets have some they are labeled data, so every network comes with a label. And here we just try to predict the real world label of a network. And as you see again, we outperform previous works. So here there is a, I highlight those three tests circuits that they also do well. Actually, the best performer is this one, if you notice. So actually, our performance is always above others. So that's what we have achieved with this work. We achieved an expressive graph comparison method that achieves the properties of permutation invariance, scalability, and size invariance. It is also scalable to compute. And that is called NetLSD. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Yeah, so let me wrap up. This guy, a really